Was it over a period of time?
It was over a period of time of like a week, but when it started, it dropped so quickly, and people were just scrambling to get what they could. And as when people scrambled to get what they could, everyone was on a bearish market, which practically means everyone is selling off their Bitcoin so that they can gain whatever profits. And because of that, everything just crashed.
Wow, that is very tragic. And you know, that's the thing with investments. There are days when the market is bullish, that is the prices are rising, and then there are times when it's bearish, the prices are falling. And you know, it's a cycle that keeps happening, up down, up down, up down. But before we get into that, I want to ask a little bit. I want my viewer to get to know a little bit about you. So, did you grow up in Nairobi? Did you study in Nairobi, your business course, or had you traveled out of the country for a while?
Should I explain like my whole life story from birth?
No, just basically, because when you said that you started a company when you were in uni, that's what is making me ask this question, because I think that that is very innovative and very good, because a lot of people go to uni and, you know, they want to finish and get a job. So when you're in uni and you start a company, that is already a very different path, which is awesome. So I want to know, were you in a Kenyan uni, or were you in a outside?
I was in a satellite campus in Nairobi.
Yes, okay.
It was a school called EduLink International College. So I was doing a business course, but it was from the UK, from the University of Northampton. And my
Excellent.
friends and I just decided, you know what, let's just start something.
Awesome. So basically, because of that, your life now went more into business and into investments. When you left, did you get a job, or have you been employed before, or have you tended to be in business?
Yes, I also got employed immediately after I graduated. Like, lucky for me. I'm not a part of the what's it called, unemployment statistic. I was a real estate agent for exactly a year, and I stopped to do cryptocurrency.
Excellent. All right. So that's very exciting. I also have been lucky, because when I finished my uni, that was in 2003. Yeah. Just the other day, or a long time ago.
It's just the other day, man. Just the other day.
I remember I graduated in September, and then I got a job in January. So I've also been lucky in terms of not have had not I've not had to job hunt for a long time. And then I got employed for 6 months, and then got into business. So I've been in business actually almost all my life, which is like 15 years. So it's good to know that you've had a bit of employment and you've had a bit of business, and then you got into cryptocurrency. And what is interesting is that a lot of people, first of all, do not understand what cryptocurrency is. So before we even get so much into the conversation, could you just explain to us what is cryptocurrency, so that the person who is watching us can be able to have a
No
basic
problem.
understanding?
No problem. Now, cryptocurrency is a combination of two things. There's the cryptography, which is basically encryption, where it's you can't really access stuff, and then also currency, which is now money and what is put value to it. Now, when you put those things together, encrypted and currency, it becomes cryptocurrency, meaning that it's encrypted money. And then encryption, trade,
All right. And you know what? Just to break it down to very, very little bit of size pieces, WhatsApp usually says that it's encrypted. That means that there is a security around a privacy. Like you is that what encryption means? Like it is protected.
It is protected. Now,
Okay.
the cryptocurrency is built on this technology called the blockchain. And the blockchain is just a bunch of computers that are connected together to be able to have a consensus to verify a new block, which the new block is where I'm sending a transaction from me to you, and that block would encode it so that that transaction goes through, and the computers will verify that transaction. And within that new block, that's our transaction.
Ah, okay, okay. It gets a little bit technical, but it's good to understand it. And it's good that you understand it because you're the cryptocurrency trader. So it's very important that you understand it a lot. So, all right. Yeah. So basically, when people talk about cryptocurrencies, the one that stands out the most is Bitcoin. And now with my understanding, my limited understanding, I've come to realize that there are very many cryptocurrencies. So can you give us a few examples, like, so that people can know that it's not just Bitcoin that is the cryptocurrency?
No problem. Now, Bitcoin was practically the father of all the cryptocurrencies. It's the one that, well, mother, to be specific, because it birthed all the other cryptocurrencies. There's other currencies such as Ethereum, where now Ethereum has a different type of technology in comparison to Bitcoin. Bitcoin uses a proof of work consensus algorithm, where it's slow and steady, and it takes a lot of time to verify a transaction. While Ethereum uses more of a proof of stake, which is practically where you put your money into, and that you have proof of that is your money, and that is your money that is working in the market. Now, Ethereum is also built off of smart contracts. And with those smart contracts comes other cryptocurrencies, where they now can build other smart contracts. There's some called Cardano, there's others called Algorand, there's my personal favorite right now is called Pundai X. It's a long-term hold. If you guys want, this is secret information.
Insider trading.
yeah, insider trading. And there's many more like that.
All right.
Those are just very few.
Okay, that's good to know. I'm happy to know that Bitcoin is not the only cryptocurrency. There's so many others. And then another thing is, why is there a need for cryptocurrency? Is it that there's something wrong with the physical money that we have? What is it that has led to the birth of it? I know everything has gone digital. Therefore, that's one example, that since everything has gone digital, even this interview is digital, right?
It is online, digital.
Because there's a lockdown. So is that the reason why money also has to become digital? Or are there other fundamental reasons that led to the rise of cryptocurrency?
Yes, there are other fundamental reasons. An example for at least for one issue that Bitcoin had solved is double spending. Now, when you go to a bank, sometimes I know with my bank, like, you can double spend and they're going to have to repay you back with credit or something. But then with Bitcoin, because it's put up on a public ledger, and once that Bitcoin has been sent, it can't be sent again.
All right. I don't understand what you mean by double spending, because what I know is that when I have 100 shillings in my pocket,
mm-hmm.
and I spend it once, I go to the Mama Boga and I buy some tomatoes, I have already mm-hmm. spent it once. Do you mean that I can now spend it again? What is double spending?
Double spending is where there's a glitch in a system where it records you spending twice, but by accident. And it's not actually dealing with physical cash, but it's actually solving the bank systems. And the banking systems have actually always had that issue and have been always trying to solve it so that they can make it work. But cryptocurrencies, and a cryptocurrency such as Bitcoin, solves that issue.
You can only spend it once.
You can only spend it once.
All right. So that seems to be a benefit that is a bit above the normal Mwananchi like me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because it's about banks and everything. On a personal level,
yes.
problem do I have that is solved by cryptocurrency, if any?
Okay. With cryptocurrency, it's decentralized. So it's you who's actually controlling your wealth. and actually sending it to people, to whoever you want to send it, wherever in the world. And it's very easy to get into it because all you need to do is just to download an app. Well, in comparison to like a bank, you have to go through so many different types of protocols to just verify that it's you who has the bank account.
Yeah.
So
it's very easy to get started on that kind of a platform because, yeah, you're right. When you want to open a bank account, there's so many requirements, so many restrictions. And let's talk about something interesting, tax. You know, tax is a big issue right now that's it's giving people a lot of interesting headaches. So is cryptocurrency tax?
In some places it is, and in some places they're still figuring out, and in other places it isn't.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So I like that you've introduced in some places, in other places. What is the Kenyan situation? Is Bitcoin, is it, I don't know whether to use the term legal or illegal. Those may not be the right term.
No.
Yeah. How is it with Bitcoin going in Kenya?
Currently, Bitcoin is just being worked with the common people. So like there's a small community of people who trade between each other and are like, so it's not really as big as it should be in Kenya for it to be taxed. And currently the CBK, I know, is trying to figure a way to be able to regulate it. Because currently in Kenya, it's unregulated. And because the space is picking up, there's going to have to be some regulations that are going to have to come through to be able to save people's finances, you know?
I know, okay. And regulation, that's one of the things that cryptocurrencies try to avoid, regulation. It's basically about a completely free market that is not regulated by any government, by any individual. So when I hear that CBK wants to start regulating it, then already I'm feeling like that's a bit of a loss on the free side of things. But well, I mean, that's how government is, always wanting to regulate and you know, let's not veer off into that, but that's the way it is. So let's talk about the opportunity. What opportunities are there in Bitcoin that we should be taking advantage of now? Because it is something that is rising, and it is an opportunity for Africa. What is the opportunity? And are people seeing the opportunity, or are we going to also be bypassed by it?
There's plenty of opportunities specifically with Bitcoin, because with Bitcoin, you don't actually have to own one full Bitcoin. You can have any amount of a Bitcoin up to 8 decimal places, which is insane. If you think about it, like, that's just insane. You can have less than 1 shilling in Bitcoin. And if you just have that, you'll be able over years to come, because it's a volatile asset that always appreciates. It will do you justice. Now, where Africans are going with the cryptocurrencies is that they're using it as a way to go outside of like the Western countries' sanctions and like the Western trade connections and all that, so that they can be able to decentralize the whole system for themselves and be able to also have value to what they're buying and selling. Like, I know the government of Nigeria are actually working with the communities to be able to implement cryptocurrencies in the government so that they can be independent for themselves.
So it's a good opportunity to be able to be independent, to be able to cut away the middleman. Because a lot of expenses come up because of using a middleman, like using a bank, using, people who allow you to use their platforms charge you, and those charges become a lot.
And then the charges and they compound,
and you may not realize it, but you know, that compounding is a loss on your part, right? Because you're losing money for no value at all. You're creating value. You're giving some away your money for nothing. It's a, as a church. So I think that's an opportunity right there. And for a long time, Bitcoin has been associated with so much lack of information. In fact, some people feel like it's a game of being conned. I don't know why that's the feeling in the market. Is it something that, you know, in Kenya, we've had a lot of pyramid schemes. We've had whale, whale business. And so there's a lot of skepticism about Bitcoin and about cryptocurrencies. Is there anything that can be done about that to sort of make it look like a legit and understandable now, business?
Yes. Now, what I usually tell my clients and also my friends and my family when talking about cryptocurrencies and the skepticism that they have is that, one, D-Y-O-R, do your own research.
Do your own research, okay. D-Y-O-R, I like that, okay.
Because I know, even from like the past of things, and I know, I feel like it's human nature to be scared of things that you don't know,
yeah,
or things that you don't understand. And because you don't understand it, you have a hate for it. And I'm not attacking anyone. I'm just saying that I feel like that's just how human nature is.
And you know, also, just to add on to what you're saying, and then after you hate it, you tend to demonize it. So now it becomes like witchcraft.
Exactly.
I know that's an African thing. The things you don't understand, you demonize them, and then they become spiritual and negative. Mm. And then you lose out on something that is good. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And I know that people also take advantage of people who actually don't know about cryptocurrencies. Like, I'm going to be honest, I have been scammed before. Guys, this place, it's difficult and it hurts. But
there are people there.
Yeah. It's good to know what is a scam and what isn't a scam, and how to actually identify it. And that's why I enjoy educating people onto finding different ways to get inside cryptocurrencies and also to use your cryptocurrencies and to not be scammed as well.
Excellent. And how, for you, how have you been able to get all this skill? Is there a school you went to, or did you just DYOR online? Or is there some mentor that you had who was able to pass on the information to you? You know, is it possible for people to follow the path that you have followed? Or does everyone now just need to create their own path? Because sometimes even when you're trying to figure out something, you're getting information, you need to verify yourself. Mm-hmm. Because you're getting the information from the wrong person, in which case already you're going down the wrong route.
Yes. Now, mostly for me, what I did was I did my own research, but then I also joined different types of communities and to hear what other people had to say. And I was like, okay, cool. And then I started talking with my friends, and my friends were like, yes, let's continue and let's actually invest in cryptocurrency. And so within just communities, you're able to learn and also be able to disperse with your own research and then come back and communicate and be able to share what you found, you know?
Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the returns. Kenyans are, there's certain things that Kenyans love. And mm-hmm. that number one is land. The Kenyans love to buy land and mm-hmm. they speculate on it, like get a piece of land in Kitengela and then wait for 5 years, wait for 10 years. And then your money is going to have appreciated. So mm-hmm. others go into shares. Others save their money in the bank, just accumulated by saving. Others do business, of course, where they're able to buy and sell at a higher price. What are the returns that cryptocurrency give? Are they higher or lower based on your experience? Because you've been in that market for quite a while.
It's actually really high. It is really high. And depending on where you've put your cryptocurrencies or what cryptocurrencies you have, at certain moments in time, they can 300x, 300 times within hours.
Are you seeing my face?
Yeah.
Wow,
Yeah.
that's okay. So it's very, very
It's
high
lucrative.
return,
Yeah.
lucrative. But the downside to that is that it is also highly risky, because
Yes.
that's the way investments work. High risk, high return. Low risk, low return.
Can I correct you for a bit?
Yes, please.
Investments are usually for the long term. So when you're investing, it's like, okay, I want to invest because I want to have a certain amount of money in 5 years and 10 years. But when you're trading, it's more so of like of a business, meaning the returns can be really high one day and really low the next. So as a trader, that there's a specific separation between the two. So it's like you're no longer investing, you're just trading.
I get the difference, actually. I get the difference, because when you're trading, that's when you experience the erraticness of the market, because today it's up, tomorrow it's down. But if you are going in for the long term, it is a more stable environment. For example,
It is very stable.
just to actually work with the example that you're giving, because you said that on January 22nd, 2017, Bitcoin, the day that the headache came, it moved from $25,000
Like three
per
thousand, yeah.
for one Bitcoin to 3,000. So that was in 2017. It didn't remain at 3,000. What is the current exchange rate of one Bitcoin to the dollar at the moment? This is now 2021.
2021, last I checked was a couple hours ago because I do day trade. It's 57,000, ranging
Exactly.
to $60,000.
So you can see that though it went from 25,000 to 3,000, it is now at 58 to 60,000. Therefore, the people who did not sell in 2017 have recovered and even have better value right now. So I get the difference of what you're basically trying to say, that in the long term, it's more like a sure bet. But if you're trading, then you do have the ups and downs. And that is very different from the stock market. Well, the stock market, it's become confusing of late. It's become confusing. I mean, like when you look at something like let's say KQ shares, there's a time they were 250, and that was like the best time for KQ shares. Then they came down, and I don't know if they'll ever recover, because who knows? I mean, they've been at Tubob for so long.
We just have to wait for our kids to find out.
And Muvia, you at least I have kids, Now for you talking about your kids who have not even come, it is such a long time. It's such a loss, especially if you had like a huge percentage of shares, like 10%. I mean, when are you ever going to recover? So I hear you in the sense that Bitcoin is more stable, because it seems to be picking up with more knowledge and more information. It seems to be like a sure bet. So now that that is sorted, I hope for my viewers, let's talk about the details of dealing. Because it's digital, it's not something you're touching. We're so used to your 100 bob, your 1,000, your 20 bob, your 5 bob, or your M-Pesa.
Yes.
At least we're able to move from, we do have mobile money, so it's in
Yes,
your.
we do.
So now when it's not in your phone, it's not in your wallet, where is it when you have Bitcoin? Is it somewhere in the air, or where is it?
Now, there's two ways that you can have your Bitcoin. You can store it on a custodial wallet, which is a digital wallet, which is created by a complex hash system that gives you a specific address that to show that this is your wallet. Now, on the custodial wallet, that means an exchange controls or at least holds your private keys. So those private keys are like practically the key to your gold. It's a key to your safe. It's like the passwords and everything. And you can keep that on an exchange when you're day trading. But then now that's this custodial, but we also have the other side, which is non-custodial. Now, this is where you have all the power for your wealth and you can hold all your Bitcoin. This is where there's certain things such as key seed phrases, which can amount to 12, 24 or 48 phrases as a password for your wallet. Now, never share those seed phrases with anyone, because that's literally, as I said before, the key to the safe.
It's like your PIN, your for
it's like your PIN.
You never share it with anybody.
Mm-hmm. It's like your PIN. And
so there are people trying to get you to give it to them, the way there are people who try to call you and ask you a couple of questions so that you divulge your PIN by mistake. Does that happen with cryptocurrency? Are there online people who will try and
yes, for sure. If a place says, please share your seed phrase with us for something, don't do it.
That's no. This is your PIN.
That's no.
That is a thief you're dealing with right there.
Yeah, that's a thief you're dealing with. Don't do it. And also don't share your private wallet, because there's two wallets that you get on a non-custodial wallet. There's the public wallet and then the private wallet. The private wallet is the one which is just meant for yourself and is meant for any specific receivables, any specific transactions that you're going to get with that private wallet. But then with a public wallet, you can literally put it anywhere, and whoever wants to send you money can send you money.
Okay. So I'm hearing that basically, you know, you have it in a wallet, in a digital wallet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So in a digital wallet.
The same way you have a physical wallet, you have a digital wallet. And the same way you have a bank account that is more private than your wallet, you have the public wallet and you have the private wallet. So it's really mirrored very closely to the real life currencies that we know. And that makes understanding it easier. But let's talk a little bit about transaction. Let's say I have money in my wallet, my public or private wallet, and I want to buy. What are some of the things right now that I can buy using Bitcoin in Kenya? Because I live in Kenya, and I'm not relocating at the moment. There's even nowhere you can go for now until the doctor eases. So what is it that I can buy with Bitcoin right now?
Now, it depends with the person that you're going to be transacting with, because you can just ask them, hey, may I please purchase this in Bitcoin instead of Kenyan shillings or instead of the US dollar? And if the person is open to that, then they can accept it. Currently in Kenya, there aren't any cryptocurrency services where you can exchange your crypto for an item. However, there's an exchange called crypto.com that have partnered with Visa to be able to do that. And you know, with Visa you can be able to spend anywhere with your Visa card. Or at least anywhere that can accept Visa. And because if that place accepts Visa, it can also accept crypto. Yeah. So there's now a card that gets distributed around. Well it's not just one card, sorry. But like there's a card that you can get that has Visa applications on it, where you can be spending your cryptocurrency. It will get exchanged on the card, and then you'll be able to buy that item with the Visa card.
Is that something you've done yourself? Yeah.
No, not yet. I've not done it myself yet.
Okay, but then what about other parts of the world? Like, let's say, which country can you be able to buy a car using Bitcoin, for example, just based on the knowledge you have?
Recently, Elon Musk allowed Tesla to be able to transact in Bitcoin. So like if you want to buy a Tesla vehicle, you can buy it through using your Bitcoin if you want to. And it's pretty cool that they've done that because that means they put Bitcoin onto the main mainstream channels, and the price is still going to skyrocket for one Bitcoin.
Exactly. And you know what? Just following a little bit, I'm just thinking about the certain places you can be able to transact with currency that is not cash, neither is it M-Pesa. For example, your things like miles, you're able to exchange miles and you can sort of fly with them. You can also go to a market and use your Bonga points. You can actually use your Bonga points to purchase a phone. You can use your Bonga points nowadays even to shop at Naivas. So, and of course, you're the one who is in control of the points and you know what the value of one Bonga point is, etc. So I think that we are getting more and more examples of how it is to purchase using cryptocurrency. So what I hear right now is that at the moment in Kenya, what you can do is you can exchange your cryptocurrency into Kenya shilling,
Yeah, you
either
can.
by selling it to somebody or by withdrawing it, maybe even using a Visa card on an ATM somewhere if it is allowed. But I think right now the easiest, most common way is to sell to someone and that person gives you money in Kenya shilling.
Yes,
Okay. And that is
that
something
is great.
That's something that you've experienced.
Yeah, that is something I experience and I do on a monthly basis.
Ah, I like that statistic on a monthly basis because it also means that it's frequent. It's not like a once a year kind of thing. All right. So in your time as a cryptocurrency trader, how are you seeing like people are more accepting of the idea now, or they still feel it's a bit too new?
Now, there's a lot of young people are more open to it because I know people in the space who are always saying that this is the future of currency because how currency has always developed from barter trade to now coins and shells to paper money to well to gold then paper money and then the next step is now to cryptocurrencies. And there's people who are accumulating it on very slowly but surely so that in like 10 years' time they'll be sorted. It's and
Okay,
they'll be sorted in 10 years.
they'll be sorted because basically, if the value goes on appreciating the way that it is, it's going to be something quite big. And you know what? There's always people who are saying the bubble will burst. Like the real estate bubble in Kenya has been bursting for so
It's
long.
been bursting for so long.
In Baka, we are like, when is this burst happening?
Like I know there's some conservatives who actually hate against Bitcoin, but the only people who I know or and I've seen that hate against Bitcoin are people who are like at least in the 50s or just older than me, just like the baby boomers. Or the boomer generation.
And to be very honest, it is a lack of information, a lack of understanding, a lack of being able to just wrap your head around the fact that it can happen, you know. So because of that, you sort of end up hitting on it. But the young generation are very open to new ideas. They're more
Accommodating.
aware and understanding because they were born that way in the computer era. I mean, I don't know if you can remember that. There's a while back when banks wanted to be computerized, and my mom was working at a bank, and the bank went on strike. The workers went on strike because they didn't want computers. And looking back, there's no way they could have won that battle. So even this one talking about currencies, I think it is just an idea whose time has come, and there's no like turning back from it. And I still feel like I need to hear more about how people can be able to get onto this bandwagon. If you want to start trading, do you offer classes or do you offer, how do you help people who want to start?
I offer like specific mentorships where I assist the person. I teach them about everything that to deal with blockchain, to deal with crypto and different types of tokens. And I lay the foundation to be able to, okay, this is how you can buy, this is how you can sell. And this is the technical analysis that you should be able to take and use and be able to have a quick mind, if you want to have a quick mind, to be able to get into a good position and position yourself well in the market. And then also to find good times when to pull out of the market, to not always just stay inside. Because people do suffer from that. And it's a, there's also a term for it called overtrading, where you're just constantly addicted to the market. So you're just trading and trading and trading. You're buying and selling and buying and selling and buying and selling, and you're not stopping. And it's kind of detrimental to the health. But I do teach people onto how to get onto the platforms, and especially in Kenya, because in Kenya, currently, it's very difficult to get into it. And very few people who know about cryptocurrencies and want to get into cryptocurrencies don't know how to get into cryptocurrencies. And so I'm there to fill in that gap, to be able to bridge the people who want to get into it, to get into it.
All right. So if people want to reach out to you, for example, after watching this program, what are some, do you have a website or are you on social media so that people can be able to connect with you?
Yes, I am on social media. I just use my personal social media because I just leave my charts there sometimes and people DM me questions. Should I see my social media?
Yeah, see my social media. That's the way it happens. Like you put yourself out there, sometimes people get in touch with you. And you never know how these social media interactions, they can lead anywhere, you know.
They can lead anywhere. Yeah.
So they can lead anywhere, and it's just the way people are interacting nowadays. So what are your social media handles that people can be able to reach out to you on?
On Instagram, I have Muvya, Muvya. And I also have crypto.g, also short for Crypto Genie. It's where I've been posting a lot of cryptocurrency educational tools and educational forms of education. So right now I'm focusing mostly on Instagram. That's where they can find me.
Okay. So Muvya or crypto.g, if you want to get into the cryptocurrencies, please head there and Movie is going to be able to, you know, sort you out. Of course, for a fee. It's not free, right?
This is
a skill. This is knowledge. And so for it to be shared, you've got to pay for it, because it's just the same way if you went to school to do a course in XYZ, you pay school fees. So it's the thing, right? It's good to give people that understanding, because a lot of times, on social media, sometimes with those connections, you're not able to get value for what you're offering. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that's good to clarify. And we're about to come to the end of the show, so I hope that you can start thinking of. Yeah. Start thinking of of like a parting shot that you'd want to give to our viewers. But tell us a little bit more about, for example, Ethereum. Can you buy Ethereum also a portion of, for Ethereum? Do you have to buy one whole one?
No, it's actually with every cryptocurrency. You don't have to buy one whole cryptocurrency. And with Ethereum, it also has the 8 decimal places. But in comparison to Bitcoin, where one unit of a Bitcoin is called a Satoshi, which is just something that to remember the creator of Bitcoin, because his name was Satoshi Nakamoto, or her name or their name, because we don't know they're anonymous. One unit of Ethereum is called a GWEI.
Mm-hmm. What does that mean? Is it to remember the person as well?
No, there's not much to it. I believe it was Vitalik Buterin, the creator of Ethereum. He's a very smart guy. I don't understand. He looks like an alien.
The geeker.
He looks like an alien. Like, he has the big head and everything and skinny body.
He needs a lot of brains to come up with some of these things, right? to be housed anyway.
He came up with the proof of stake, where it's you just put a little bit of your Ethereum, and that amount of Ethereum that you have is what is proof of what you have. So you don't really have to mine it. You can just have it and it'll mine for you.
Okay, that sounds a bit... I know you think that I'm understanding, which I am, but as opposed to Bitcoin, where what you have is not what you have.
Mm-hmm.
So in Bitcoin, what you have is not may not necessarily be with
you. No. Bitcoin is treated as a store of value. The same way gold is treated as a store of value, Bitcoin is now the digital gold. Ethereum is like now the place where smart contracts can happen, where law can actually be implemented through code.
Okay.
Through code. And that means anything that you want to have and want to work for can be implemented and that is it. There's no form of error to it.
Okay.
Because the reason why it was made is because of human error. Because humans are prone to error, the code is barely prone to error because it just does what it says it does.
Okay. So in that sense, it might be a safer bet to start with because it sort of sounds more secure-ish, sort of.
It's very widespread and give birth to the rest of the cryptocurrency markets, like one of them being Cardano, that has built its own blockchain for complete decentralization, where myself and you can be a part of that blockchain to be able to verify transactions. So it's complete decentralization.
Okay. And correct me if I'm wrong, but the fact that there are many cryptocurrencies means that even when you're dealing, you can actually deal the same way people do Forex, like, you buy against the dollar, you buy against the pound, you buy against all the types of shillings. You can also do that within the cryptocurrencies. Like, they do have exchange rates.
Yes, they do have exchange rates and pairings. It is what it's usually called. So with Bitcoin, you can have an Ethereum pair. You can have a Binance pair, which is also called a BNB token. That's where I usually exchange all my cryptocurrencies on the Binance platform. It's very good. It makes it easy for expert traders and also for easy traders to start building that portfolio and learning how to trade.
All right. I'm so happy to have talked to you today. And one of the things that you told me when we were off the show is that you don't have to have a minimum requirement to start trading, which is usually good to know, because a lot of people want to invest but they only have a handful or a thousand, or and then they're going to where they're going to, they're being told you need to have a minimum of, let's say, 10,000
or even 100,000
or even 100, even 250. So I think that's another huge benefit of cryptocurrencies, that you can start with any amount.
So
you don't have to feel like what you have is not enough. What you have is enough to start. So
And when you start, there's a good way that you can start. There's this technique or strategy that people use called dollar cost averaging. This is where you set certain intervals for the amount that you want to put in, and put in that certain amount regardless of whatever the price is. That way, if you even if you put in 1,000 bob when it's high, and then if the market goes down and you put in 1,000 bob again when it was low, but like once every week or once a month, the next month, you'll see that the pricing of this and the pricing of putting it here would average out. And for the long-term investing or long-term trading, which is actually investing, for the long-term investing, it's seen that it has a higher percentage rate of returns in comparison to day trading. When you dollar cost
That's
average.
great. Yeah, because now
So
you buy high and you buy low, you're able to get an average so that you're not really focusing on the price at entry, but you're focusing on the goal of accumulating a certain amount by a certain time and then enjoying the appreciation. All right, cool. Thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure. Please give us a parting shot before we wrap up the show.
Thank you for having me, and thank you, GPS TV, for this. It's been lovely. And one parting shot I want to give people, always buy the dip.
Always buy the dip. Buy when it's going down, no?
Always buy the dip.
Okay. That makes sense. Don't buy when it's going up, right? Okay. Thank you so much for that. You're very investment savvy, but I guess it is because of the many years of experience. How long have you been a cryptocurrency trader?
I started in 2016, and then I fell off of it because of the 2017 crash. And then I got back into it last year because I found a new passion for it, and it has just been nonstop, and it's been going pretty well for me, and I can't
All
wait
right.
to see where it goes for the next 5 years.
Excellent. Thank you so much. And one last question before we wrap up. What are
No
you
problem.
able to tell what caused the crash in 2017? Or is it just market forces?
Yes, actually, it was the government of the United States trying to put an end to Bitcoin, where they were like trying to release licenses so that you can be able to trade in the currency. And that put like a whole halt onto the Bitcoin regime. But for something as strong as that, you just have to join because you can't beat it.
You can't beat it. Yeah, because you see, they tried to beat it, and that made people panic sell, which means that Bitcoin was now flooded, and therefore the price went down because we're trying to basically halt it. So, and so, look at it, like 4 or 5 years later, it still was able to overcome. So, that's a very good sign of the fact that external forces are not able to completely interfere, which means that it's a strong currency that you want to have, right? All right, everybody, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been such a great pleasure. And Muvia, thank you so much because you've broken down something that is very technical and you have made it seem possible. So please go out there and get into something new. We are on lockdown and this is also a good opportunity to just try something new. Try with a little money and then see how it goes. And then as you see, as you learn more and as you discover more, you're going to be more confident to put in more. And it's the way of the future and there's no stopping it. So I think the earlier you get onto the bandwagon, the better for you. Thank you so much and bye for now. See you next time.